Good morning. There's an excitement in the sanctuary this morning. I think it's probably because of the change in the season, the beauty of God's creation, and because of these precious individuals that are seated up here right now, too. I think that's it. We got our preacher. He said it's because we got our preacher back. That's what it is. We're excited. Absolutely. We are delighted. We prayed for Dr. Hankins and for the Bow Sarges, and God answered our prayer. And we're delighted that they are back here this morning. The preschool choir is going to come lead us in worship. Now, folks, they're not performing. They're worshiping God. You worship God with them. Very simple song, and you could probably sing along kind of softly with them. Very easy song, and it's scripture. It is a scripture song. So as Miss Ashley Barkley leads us in the preschool choir singing, "Love the Lord," prepare your hearts to worship Him this morning.
Thank you, children, for leading us in worship this morning. Hey, Ann Waverly. And for reminding us that the very first and greatest commandment is to love the Lord our God with all our heart and our soul and our mind and strength. That is the very essence of worship. We love Him because He first loved us. Well, good morning and welcome to worship with our first Fairhope family believers on this beautiful spring day. I think we can officially say that spring has sprung. I know the pollen in the air certainly reminds me every day that it's here. But anyway, we're so glad you've joined us this morning. Whether you're watching us online or you're here with us in person this morning, it's a great day to be here. If you're a first-time guest or if you've never yet filled out our Connect card, we'd love to have a record of your time with us. So you can do that one of two ways. First of all, the simple way is just take out your cell phone, text the word welcome to the number you'll see on the screen. And then when the Connect card comes up, just fill it out and send it back in. Or for those of you that are here in the sanctuary, there's also a hard copy of the card. You can take it and fill it out, drop it in the offering plate later on in the service as you leave. Well, today, like any time we gather for worship, it's a great time to respond to whatever God is moving us to do in our life. If you've been visiting with us for a while and you're looking for a church family to call home, or maybe today you feel God's moving in your heart and you need to accept Him for the very first time as your Lord and Savior. Whatever that is today, we encourage you to come forward at the end of our service. We have our time of decision and let one of our pastors know what God is leading you to do today. Now, if you would, please bow your head as Todd Edmiston comes to lead us in praying to the one who is worthy of our worship.
Let us pray. Oh, Lord, it is good to see your glory. It is good to see these young ones. Father, I am humbled to speak to you today because you are the Almighty God. You are worthy of all praise. Father, we sing praise to you. We lift you up. Today, Father, as we sing our praise, as we honor you, I pray that you would meet us here in this place. Come to us because we love you, Lord. We love you, Lord. We thank you that you have provided salvation through your Son, Jesus. We know that every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord, and that glory will be to you as our Father. Father, we exalt you. We humbly come before you because you deserve all of this glory. Father, I thank you that Dr. Hankins and the Bosarges are back, that they have gone and traveled your kingdom, and they have seen your kingdom, and we long to hear their report today. Father, I long to see that your kingdom comes here and that we can be a part of it. But Father, as you come to us through this praise, I know that there are those of us that cannot meet us here. I pray that you would be with them. I know that there are folks that are hurting, that need your comfort, that they're sick and they need your healing. I know there are wars raging and people have needs. And I pray that you would provide those needs, that you would show us your miracle, show us your hands. Be with us. And Lord, I pray today that you would speak through Dr. Hankins. He is your servant leader you have provided us with. I pray for his leadership. I pray for the words that he speaks to be your words. And I pray that all of our leaders, both here and throughout this world, would listen to you. They would lead us not into temptation. And that, Lord, you would deliver us from evil. And Father, I now ask that you hear our praise. You are worthy of all of our praise, and that you meet us here, and you be glorified through our worship. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness. Being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Thank you for the cross, Lord. Thank you for the price you paid, bearing all my sin and shame. In love you came. For this love, Lord, thank you for
together. Father, you are worthy of this praise. And I'm overwhelmed and brought back again to the abundance of the life that flows from you as I lift my voice with my brothers and sisters in Christ to say things to you that express our worship. You are worthy. And you're worthy in a very specific way because God, you, the one who is sovereign and holy and righteous, good and great, and yet God, you saw fit because you're also a God of mercy and grace, that you put your glory most fully on display in sending your dear Son, the darling of heaven, crucified for us. And that's the only reason why we're able to stand in your presence today, is because our great debt of sin has been cleared in Christ alone. And so we are a people redeemed and set free from the curse of sin, from the power of death. And your Spirit makes it possible for us to say, Jesus is Lord. And so we say it, we sing it, we celebrate it, we shout it. Jesus is Lord. The truest thing that's ever been. Lord, may the truth of Christ and His word prevail in our lives together today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. And you can be seated. Open your Bibles, if you would, to Acts chapter 17. Acts chapter 17. Indeed, Bubba and Paula Bosarge and I have returned from our time in South Asia. Yes, thank you. We felt all along the way your prayers for us, not only for our safety, but most importantly that we would go to watch what God is doing in terms of mission in a place that for us is the uttermost parts of the earth. And the Lord heard and answered those prayers. And so I look forward to sharing some of that with you. And I'm going to use the term South Asia because we broadcast our worship service. We live stream them. For some security purposes for the missionaries that we worked with, I'm going to use South Asia. If you want to ask somebody near you or in Sunday school, most everybody knows where we really were, but I'm not going to use that specific term of the country that we were in, but we were in South Asia. And just real quickly, the missionaries there are not under imminent threat of physical harm. That's not what the security issue is. But because this place in the world really doesn't want missionaries, if we're not careful, we'll put the missionaries in position where they're asked to leave the country. And a tremendous investment is being made of their lives in that place, and to have to leave and start over somewhere else, learn a new language, all of those kinds of things. We do want to be careful, and that is why I'm using the phraseology of South Asia. But we were there, and very quickly, the heart of our mission, it takes a while to get to South Asia. I don't know if you know this, but they didn't put South Asia close to here, all right? So it is kind of planes, trains, automobiles, and ultimately boats. And so at the heart of our trip, we were in a river delta area, a very large river delta area of South Asia, a place that's divided up by rivulets and branches of several rivers, and the divisions are thought of best as islands. And there are 54 inhabited islands in this delta. Only 6 that we know of have any gospel witness at all. And so the Bosarges and I went to see that work. We were in 3 house churches and able to worship with and share the gospel in and teach in 3 house churches, along with 3 indigenous church planting pastors. And that's really the heart of the work, is raising up leaders among the people of South Asia so that they can do the work of planting house churches in this area where something like 5 million people are in this region and less than 1% of them have heard the gospel, have any access to the gospel. You get there by boat. All right, and so I don't know a lot about boats. Bubba was our boat expert, but something like a shrimp boat, was it sort of, kind of? Yeah, not really, I'm not doing this. It was kind of a trawler is what we were on. I felt a little bit like African Queen, if you've seen African Queen, kind of chugging along there. And wow, was it a South Asian boat. They had a Western bathroom for us, but it weren't really a Western bathroom, was it? So that was a pretty fantastic experience. They just cooked for us on the boat. I learned that in that area of the world, they don't use utensils. So they just eat with their hands. And so they just bunch up a big wad of rice and they kind of rub it around on the other things that are there, and that's how they eat. But because they knew they would be working with Westerners, they did provide us with some silverware. And what was interesting is very often they wouldn't bring it at the right time. So they would serve us a little snack and it would be like a watermelon or grape, but they would bring us silverware. And we would look at them and say, well, we don't need silverware to eat watermelon. And they just looked totally confused by that. We don't know when these people want the silverware and when they don't. And so we went to the different places by boat, slept on the boat one night. That was an experience. And then they found a $13 hotel for us. And we got our money's worth at the $13 hotel. There came with all kinds of insects and interesting things to look at and be around there. But those little challenges paled in comparison to the beauty of those precious people, to the power of the gospel to transform lives, to the work of the Holy Spirit that's moving, to the little churches that are being planted and multiplying unbelievably, to getting the privilege of being around fellow believers who are fairly consistently persecuted for their faith and yet boldly gather in the name of Jesus Christ week by week. And to see fields that are white unto harvest. One of the things that I want you to hear, and as we seek to get a vision for this uttermost part of the earth aspect of our ministry together as a church, is that this area, South Asia, has the largest concentration of lostness in the world. So South Asia has the largest concentration of lostness in the world. One of the main reasons is because it just has a huge population. One of the things we saw in that area is there are people everywhere. Millions and millions and millions and millions of people. Just in the large region that we were in, there were 5 million. And in the larger section that our missionaries are working in, there are 229 million people. Less than 1% know Jesus. And so one of the reasons I believe God's calling us to connect with this place in the world is because it is a massive concentration of lostness. And I'll talk more about that in just a few moments. And there are so many things that I could share with you this morning, and I'm going to take opportunities in the days, weeks, and months to come as we catch this vision together to share all the different things we experienced and encountered. I won't spend very much time at all talking to you about our time in the cities, these huge mega cities, millions and millions and millions of people, and the lostness that's there and the needs that's there. But I felt the Lord stir my heart to Acts chapter 17 because in Acts 17, beginning in verse 16, we find Paul in Athens and he is moved by the fact that the city is filled with idols. And so we were in a place in the world, in the cities, in the countryside, everywhere we went, we would go to these unbelievably poor sections of South Asia, the hovels, huts, and yet there would be a gleaming Hindu temple filled with idols. Nearly every little dwelling we went into that weren't Christian dwellings, had evidence of idol worship, Hindu worship. And that context put me or moved my heart towards Acts 17 when Paul is in Athens and his heart is broken over the fact that the city is filled with idols. It's filled with false worship. It's filled with people who do not know the one true living and saving God. And what's so powerful about the text that we're going to look at is it's a thumbnail sketch. Paul doesn't spend a lot of time in Athens, and so you have this very concentrated description of what Paul was up to in that city. But in it, because of its brevity, you do see so clearly the missionary task. We're getting to watch Paul do what Paul does. We watch Paul do his job. And I was struck, and the thing I want to highlight this morning with you, the thing that so overwhelmed me was the honor and the privilege of watching the missionaries that you support, watching our missionaries do their job. I was blown away by these men and their families who have given their lives. And I watched them do kingdom work. I watched them do their job. And it reminded me of the task. That's the title of my sermon this morning, is the task. All Christians have one job. All Christians have one job. And it was a joy over those days together to watch a missionary. I'm going to call him Robert. That's not really his name, but just again for security reasons. Got to watch Robert do his job. And isn't it fun to watch someone who's really, really, really good at their job? I saw a guy doing glass blowing. Anybody ever watch somebody do glass blowing? Okay, making things. And this guy was awesome. I could have watched it all day. I was so impressed with someone who was so good at his job. Maybe you've had the opportunity in your professional life to hire or supervise people. Don't you appreciate it when you find someone who's good at their job? Don't you want to be served when you go into a business or establishment by someone who's good at his or her job? And what makes someone good at his job? I think there are three things. There are lots of things that can make someone good at his job. But three of the things that are going to come out of this text is, first of all, passion. When people care about what they're doing, it shows up in the way they work, right? Don't you want to see people who care about what they're doing? You ever been served by someone who obviously didn't care? Didn't care about you, didn't care about the job, didn't care about the business? It's not good. Second is a deep grasp of the job. They know what they're doing. They know what they're about. They know the content of what they're seeking to accomplish. Ever been served by someone who had no idea what they were really doing? Didn't understand the job? Didn't know how the things worked? And then thirdly, if you're hiring someone, you want someone who's passionate. You want someone who really understands the job. And thirdly, you want someone who can solve a problem, right? You want someone who can solve a problem, who even when the thing they've been trained for, something comes up and it's different and it's new, you want someone who moves towards the difficulty, moves towards things that are hard instead of running away. And that's what we see Paul doing. That's what we see the missionary task being all about. That's what I watched Robert do in an incredible way. And I want you to know this. Every Sunday that you give, a portion of what you get supports men and women like Robert. And that's a good thing. And when you give to Lottie Moon, every year we promote the Lottie Moon offering, all of that goes to fund the work that missionaries like Robert are doing. And I can bring you back a report from the other side of the world that men and women who are serving in the International Mission Board are careful stewards of the resources you put in their hand, and they're doing an awesome job. They're good at their job. And it forced me to ask the question of myself, well, am I good at my job? And it's caused me to come back to a question for you. Are you good at your job? Are you doing your job? And are you good at it? All Christians have one job. And it can be described in various ways in the scripture, but we, when you sum it all up, we are to be about the expansion of the kingdom of God. We're to see the kingdom of God grow. And when the kingdom of God grows simultaneously, the kingdom of this world, the kingdom of Satan shrinks. You have one job. And the gospel is the power of the kingdom. The good news of Jesus Christ, the announcement that Jesus is Lord, means there is a king, and he oversees a kingdom, and that kingdom is ruling, and it's reigning, and it starts by ruling and reigning in the hearts of men and women. They've got to be changed in their spirit and changed in their minds, transformed in the inside, and then their marriages are transformed, and their families are transformed. Homes, neighborhoods are transformed, and their villages and cities are transformed, and the church becomes a place where transformed people are gathering and showing forth the glory of new creation and the coming kingdom of Christ. You got one job. There's all kinds of different ways to do it. And the Lord sets you in a particular family, in a particular job, in a particular neighborhood, in a particular city. But the details are different. The job is the same. We are to be proclaimers of the kingdom of God. And it was good to watch someone who was really good at that. And it's good to ask ourselves the same question. Are we good at this job? And so let's watch Paul for a moment. I'm just going to ask you to be seated this morning because the text is a little bit long, but I want you to see the shape of things. And so beginning in verse 16 of chapter 17 of the book of Acts, Luke writes, "Now while Paul was waiting for them," he's waiting for Timothy and Silas. He's waiting for them, and he's in Athens. "Paul's spirit was being provoked within him as he was observing the city full of idols. So he was reasoning in the synagogue with Jews and God-fearing Gentiles and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be present. And also some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers were conversing with him. Some were saying, 'What would this idol babbler wish to say?' Others were saying, 'He seems to be a proclaimer of strange deities because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection.'" That's key right there. Paul was in Athens doing his job, proclaiming Jesus and the resurrection. "And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, 'May we know what this new teaching,'" and Areopagus is Mars Hill, it was just this particular place where they gathered, May we know what this new teaching is which you're proclaiming, for you're bringing some strange things to our ears, so we want to know what these things mean. Now all the Athenians and the strangers visiting there used to spend their time in nothing other than telling or hearing something new. So Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and he said, 'Men of Athens, I observe that you're very religious in all respects. For while I was passing through and examining the objects of your worship, I also found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. Therefore, what you worship in ignorance, this I proclaim to you. The God who made the world and all that's in it, since he's Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all people life and breath and all things. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined their appointed times and boundaries of their habitation, that they would seek God, if perhaps they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each of us. For in him we live and move and exist. Even some of your own poets have said, 'For we also are his children.' Being then the children of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art or thought of man. Therefore, having overlooked the times of ignorance, God is now declaring to men that all people everywhere should repent, because he has fixed a day in which he will judge the world in righteousness through a man whom he has appointed, having furnished proof to all men by raising him from the dead. Now, when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some began to sneer. Others said, 'We'll hear you again concerning this.' So Paul went out of their midst, but some men joined him and believed, among whom also were Dionysus the Areopagite and a woman named Damaris and others with them." What a great narrative of mission. And I don't have time to go over each detail, but I do want to hit the critical features of Paul doing his job, of a Christian doing his job, a job that needs to be done in Fairhope, a job that needs to be done in South Asia. We have a task. First of all, we have a task fueled by passion. fueled by passion. Verse 16 says that Paul's spirit was being provoked within him. In the deepest part of who Paul was, when he saw that they did not know the true and living God, they had all the wrong ideas about worship, the most important thing, it broke Paul's heart. That may be the best way to translate that. He was provoked in his spirit. The word speaks specifically of the reaction to being poked by something very sharp. Anybody ever been poked by something very sharp? What's your reaction when you're poked by something very sharp? Whoa! You don't think to yourself, well, that feels pretty good. I think I'll just stick with that. It's a reaction that demands change, an immediate response. Something is wrong and it needs to be set right, right now. All other priorities and passions subjugate themselves to the one thing that needs to be changed right now. And when Paul saw a city filled with people who did not have a relationship with the one true God, we couldn't take it. He had to begin telling them. He was deeply motivated. It has almost a sense of being angry, but he wasn't mad at the people. And frankly, maybe the best way to put it, he's mad at Satan. He's mad at the brokenness. It just won't do. It has to change, and it has to change now, because he loves these people. And so you see in the text, anyone who would listen, Jews, Greeks, philosophers, anybody who happened to be around, Paul was ready to move towards them with his love for them. He even compliments them, or tries to compliment them at the beginning of the sermon. I see that you're religious people. He's finding ways to connect with them. I've read your poets. I know you're stumbling and searching. And I want to bring you this answer that I can tell you're longing for. Even in this idol that you've dedicated to an unknown God, you know that you don't know what you need to know. And I want to share this with you because I love you and I care about you. 229 million people are in this region where Robert is working. And Bosar just can tell you, he only mentioned that about 400 times. Robert almost can't bear the knowledge that he wakes up every day in a place where less than 1% of 229 million people know the Lord. And it's just him and his family and a handful of other families that have been tasked with this whole region. And here was the statistic that overwhelmed him the most. He did some math and he found that in this region, 9,426 new show up every day by birth. 9,000 more are born than die. And so here's what Robert knows. 6 churches of 30 members need to be planted every day. Not to deal with the 229 million who are already there, but just for the new citizens who are being born. 6 churches of 30 people every day. In the entire area that we're working, we only knew of 6 churches. The task is so great. The need is so great. And while these precious, beautiful people, friendly, they want to talk, we opened up all kinds of gospel opportunities to share with them. They were open to hearing. But oh, there's incredible spiritual darkness. I showed the video last week. We were outside a temple to Kali, the goddess of death and destruction, the goddess of sexuality. And I am telling you, profound demonic oppression is there. I think you know this, I'm not Mr. Spiritually Sensitive. I don't see a demon behind every tree and that sort of thing. But I am telling you, when people were gathering in the name of the goddess of darkness, calling on her name and her help for power, that's why you go to Kali, because you need power to impose your will on someone else. You could almost see the priests who were working there bent and twisted by that darkness. We went to a place where they sacrifice every day, and this room is covered in blood and gore from sacrifices earlier in the day. And the people would come and put their head in the place where the goat's head was put as a part of their worship. They would kneel and put their head in the place where the sacrificial victim was. And we're seeing all of this. They're so lost. We're so lost. And Jesus is the only answer. And by their millions, they go into eternity with their trust in Kali, false goddess, a demon, no hope, no help. And you can see it in their faces. And so the need is great. And because the need is great, missionaries who are doing their job like Robert, their hearts break. And so my question for you this morning is, what do you care about? What breaks your heart? What are you passionate about? Does it bother you? Does it bother you that there's an area of the world where less than 1% of 229 million people know anything about Jesus? And if it doesn't bother you, you need to have a long conversation with the Lord about why. It broke Paul's heart. It ought to break our heart. It's a task fueled by passion. And really, until you let the passion for it overwhelm you, the other aspects of this missionary task are not going to click for you. And here really is a great question. It's not a question that's not original with me. Are you glad someone told you? Are you glad someone crossed a barrier to tell you? I am. And so, could you let that fuel you with a passion to see other people here? A task fueled by passion. Secondly, a task focused on purpose. Paul knows these people have one problem, and the one problem is their worship. They need to have a relationship with the one true and living God, and they don't. And so, Paul proclaims to them the gospel. The second half of verse 18. Because Paul was preaching Jesus and the resurrection, he had one job, which was to tell others about Jesus. Their problem and the theme of this narrative is ignorance. You do not know what you need to know. You are ignorant of the truth. And the solution to ignorance is the knowledge of the things of God. And the knowledge of the things of God comes with the proclamation of Jesus and his crucifixion and his resurrection from the dead. There's some discussion about this text, whether or not Paul is laying forth some kind of natural theology, and that's to miss the point. This is a biblical text rooted in the covenants of the Old Testament that have been fulfilled in Christ Jesus. Paul is proclaiming monotheism and election, God's appointment of the chosen one, Jesus Christ, through whom salvation will go out to the whole world. Monotheism, election, and eschatology. A judgment day is coming. The time is now. The God of history has turned the ages. And the time to say yes is now. And so Paul preaches God the Creator and his great desire for a relationship with us. God, man, he preaches about man groping. Even though they're the crown of creation, they're made for relationship. But they are sinners stumbling and they need to repent. God, man, and salvation. That's the third major aspect of theology. How you get saved. You turn from your way. You turn from your belief system. You turn from dead idols to the living God. And put your hope in Christ alone for salvation. And you can be saved. Some people say yes. And some people said no. But they heard the gospel. And today is the day of salvation. That's what I watched Robert do. Watched him share the gospel. We sat together with a little man by a little roadside in one of these little villages, Hindu man. And I watched Robert just take him through the gospel. Watched Bubba and Paula share the gospel, one of these little house churches. Watched Robert share the gospel. We were on a train in a major city. And the trains are different in this area of the world. They don't bother with doors. You ever been on a train with no doors? This isn't a train going 1 mile an hour. And we're standing on that train, packed in there. I did have to football forearm someone to get off that train. I'm just going to tell you now, I'll admit that part of it. That's a different story for a different day. But just in a quick interaction, I watched Robert share the gospel with his young college student, young engineer. Watched him beautifully and carefully turn the conversation. I guess you Westerners are here to have a good time, to party. And Robert said, no, we found something much better than anything this world can offer. He just folded it into the gospel, got the kid's number. Here's the other crazy thing about this area with billions of people in it, or 1.2 billion people in this country. They'll all give you their phone number. If you ask them, they'll just trade numbers. I saw the missionary do that several times. And here's Robert's heart. He says, we've got to stay focused on, there's too many people who need to hear it to really spend energy on anything else. You know, we went and saw where William Carey did his mission. There was a church there, and then the school that he started. And it was bittersweet, because it was great seeing the place where the father of modern missions went and began the missionary work. But the question is, 200 years later, still less than 1% of the people in South Asia, less than 1% of the people know what's been the challenge across those 200 years. And the difficulties seem to be two things, the tendencies in missions. And this is the story of William Carey and the people he worked with. One was just missional drift. Within a generation, they were more interested in publishing houses and schools, which are good things to be doing, but they were spending more time on the chores than they were on the work that was in the fields. It's easy to do missional drift, working on other things except the priority of sharing the gospel. The second problem, they had trouble getting along with each other. It's a story I'll tell on a different day by Max Lucado, but the punchline is this: when fishermen don't fish, they fight. When fishermen don't fish, they fight. And so they got to arguing about strategies and who should do what, and then they split and divide. And good thing we don't do that here in America. And so energy was spent on things that didn't have a priority around gospel proclamation leading to church planting. That's what I love about this mission. And so we were in this house church and meeting the local pastor there, and he's this good fella. He's been doing the work for a long time. And the people have been challenged. Robert challenged each one of them. Name someone specifically that you're going to share Jesus with this week. Who is it? Who is it? Who is it? He made them share. And then we're taking prayer requests, and the pastor of the little house church says, I'd like for us to pray that I can build a building. And Robert says, nope, not praying for that. And I kind of thought, ooh. And he says, brother, there's just too much work that needs to be done. We've got to plant 6 house churches today, and we don't really have time for anything else but that. Got to share the gospel with people every day. And not sort of a, you know, God's up there kind of broad-based, but we need to proclaim Jesus and his resurrection from the dead. And I watched Robert share the gospel with Hindu people who had never heard it before. And here's what they didn't say: I don't know what you're talking about. I can't comprehend the things that you're saying. They understood exactly what was being preached to them. They're smart. They're smart people. And so the task is focused on a single purpose. It's the proclamation of the gospel that transforms people, puts them into churches so that they can make the good news known to all the people around them. And then finally, lastly, it's a task frequently persecuted. They call Paul a babbler. They kind of insult him. And then they have him appear at the Areopagus. New Testament scholars are in near unanimity that you only got brought to the Areopagus to be put on trial. He's being accused of preaching foreign or strange deities. This is the exact same charge with the exact same words that Plato records Socrates being charged with and tried and executed in Athens. Paul is on trial. That's what he's doing. Most of the sermons and defenses of faith that you find in the book of Acts, they are given while men are on trial because of Jesus. And so once again, Paul's facing persecution and difficulty and threat and opposition. And he stands and he preaches the gospel. Even when and especially because it's hard. In fact, I believe Paul had a theology of opposition. That's how he knew the kingdom was moving, is when he could feel the kingdom of God crashing into the kingdom of this world and pushing it back. When we went to these house churches, little groups of 15, 20, 25 people sitting on the dirt floor to hear the gospel, every single one of them had stories of persecution. In fact, they put it like this. They would say, oh, they beat us nicely. Every single one of them had been knocked around because they had trusted Christ, kicked out of their families, experienced great financial difficulty because no one would want to work with them, the loss of potential spouses once it was found out that they were followers of Jesus. Every single one. And yet they love and serve Jesus, gather in these communities that listen to them as they sing their worship songs. And they did not let the difficulty of following Jesus prevent them from the work of ministry. I can tell you there were some challenges getting to South Asia. It's a whole different way of traveling once you get there. Traffic signals and lines on the, that doesn't mean anything. So you had to sort of get used to some of that stuff. And it was a little bit challenging putting down those rivers in 100-degree heat to get from place to place. But those hardships pale in comparison to the joy of watching the work of the kingdom. These little pastors that we were going around with, they led the captain of our boat to Christ while we were out there. These are men and their little wives doing probably six other jobs just to stay alive and yet have committed themselves not to pastoring one or two churches, but to pastoring six or seven and being persecuted to boot. And it was their joy to do so because they had been set free from the darkness of Hinduism by the glorious truth of Christ Jesus, and nothing would dissuade them. They moved towards the difficulties. They were doing their job. I believe there we have the opportunity to co-labor with them to do the job that needs to be done there, as well as the task of the mission here in the place where God has put us together in this church. But the question as I come to a conclusion is this. If you're following Jesus, if you count yourself a Christian, you would say Jesus is your Lord. The question I've brought back from the other side of the world is, are you doing your job? Passion, purpose, even when it's persecuted, even when it's hard, even when it's inconvenient, even when it's uncomfortable. Not even when, but especially because it's a privilege to suffer for the name of Christ. Are you doing your job? Would you bow your heads with me? I know And it's my prayer this morning that there may be one person or more who needs to begin the journey of faith by saying yes to this Jesus who died and rose again for them. And so if you've never said yes to this Jesus, if you've come to believe that just like those Athenians who were philosophers and sophisticated, but in all of their philosophy and earthly wisdom, they had not found a relationship with the one living God. We're going to stand and sing, and you can come and find everything you're looking for in Christ alone. Others of you, for different reasons, you're not connected to a family of faith. The Lord's had you in a season where you're discerning your will for the next step, but in order to do your job of growing the kingdom through your life, you need to be connected in a church, in an outpost of the kingdom. And so maybe today's the day you take that step of commitment to making this church your home. We are not perfect, nor are we pastored by a perfect pastor. But we are working out our salvation together with fear and trembling. And if the Spirit is directing you, I urge you to say yes today. Others of you, this altar is here for you. It is easy to get distracted. It is easy to let your life be filled with passions for other things that begin to outshine passion for the lost. Brokenheartedness over people who are trapped in darkness. And it's easy to lose the purpose, to substitute good things for gospel things. It's easy to let hardship, difficulty, opposition put you back on your heels. In our culture where salvation through Jesus alone may offend someone, or the biblical ethic no longer jihaws with the winds of our culture, and we let that push us into the shadows. And so you may just need to come here to this altar with that question and its answer in your heart, and ask God to help you do your job, be about the task of passion and purpose, even when it's hard. God, I pray that you would stir us together with a vision for the kingdom. Let that begin in me, in Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand? This hymn of invitation is for you. If the Lord has stirred your heart to give your life to Christ, to make this church your home, to surrender afresh to the task, you come as we sing.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. Hold me and make me.
Would you be seated?
Well, thank you for joining us again for worship this morning. Before we meet these who've come to be a part of our church family, just want to share a few things with you. First of all, we encourage you to join us for Bible study, which meets right after we dismiss here. We have classes for all ages and life stages, and if you're not sure where to go, if you go out here to the welcome desk, someone can direct you to one of those classes. Next Sunday is our next lunch to go, and so you can get a good meal to take home with you and support one of our ministries at the same time. This particular lunch to go will help support our Mission Scholarship Fund, which is timely since we're talking about that today. And the Mission Scholarship Fund helps us to help people like you to go on short-term mission projects here and around the world, as well as fund special mission projects from time to time. So we encourage you to sign up today. There's a sign-up table right out here, or you can also do that in your Sunday school class. Ladies, don't forget, ladies of all ages, that this coming Thursday night is Ladies' Night Out. It's 6 o'clock in the fellowship hall, and you'll have a time to hear stories of faith from various women, as well as a good meal and just some good fellowship together. So if you haven't signed up, please go online and do that as well. If you came today prepared to give back to God by giving an offering, there are offering plates at all the doors as you leave. We encourage you to do that. And if you are a first-time guest today, please go by the welcome desk right out here. We have a special gift for you today, and we'd love to have a chance to meet you. At this time, I'll ask our pastor to come and share a word about these folks.
Well, it has been good to be in God's house this morning, and the Lord has added to our number some sweet new families. And so let me introduce you first to the Gardeners, Daniel and Taylor. Y'all come stand with me here. And I met one little one. Y'all have one little baby, is that right? And she's in the nursery, I suppose. Daniel and Taylor stand before you this morning as followers of Jesus Christ. They have been seeking the Lord's will in their family of faith, and God has led them here. And so, church, if you sense the Holy Spirit leading this precious couple to be a part of our life together, would you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And I'm going to ask y'all, if you would, just to stay right here. And then the Cases, if y'all come stand here with me. And Brittany Case, good. I really messed this up last week, and so last time I was here, and so I'll do better. This is the Cases. Butch and Brittany Case here also stand before you, giving firm witness of their faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, being led by the Spirit to this decision today. They have two little girls that are in the nursery, and so thrilled that God has called them here, and they stand before you as believers in Jesus, seeking to be a part of our life together. And so, church, if you sense the Spirit directing them here in this way to be a part of our life, would you say amen? Amen. Well, let me say to you what I love to share every time God adds new members to our life together. We cannot wait to see what God's going to do in our lives because he's brought you here. You're the missing piece of our puzzle. We've been waiting for you. And so we're glad that you've listened to the Holy Spirit, and you're going to strengthen our church, make us more like Jesus because he's brought you and your gifts and abilities here. And we can't wait to see what God's going to do in your lives as you grow together, as your marriages grow, as your families grow, as your little ones grow in the Lord and come to faith in Christ. We can't wait to see how God's going to use our life together to strengthen you, make you all more like Jesus, and lead lives that proclaim him to a world that needs to hear all about him. I'm going to ask y'all to hang out, if you would, just a little bit after the worship service is over. I know folks are going to want to get to meet you. And this is just a great, wonderful sign of life as God continues to work mightily in our church. And let me say, I really do miss you when I don't get to worship with you. It was a thrill to be with fellow believers in a little house church last Sunday, praising and worshiping and singing. It's always good to come back to you, my spiritual family. Thank you for your prayers. We felt them. Thank you for your encouragement. We felt that. Thank you for your support and willingness to let me and others go and do these things. Be praying about what God would have you do. I know I didn't share a lot today about what I'm seeing spiritually. We're going to be talking about these things, pastors and deacons and mission leaders and you. But go ahead and see if you'd be willing to write God a blank check. And in these next weeks and months, that you let him fill in the details of how he would stir your heart about the greatest concentration of lostness in the world and our chance to do something about it for the glory of Christ. That's going to be neat to see what God does. Well, if you would stand, we're going to be dismissed in prayer, and y'all have a wonderful time in Bible study. Brent?
Please join me in prayer. Father, it's been so good to be in your house today with your people. Father, thank you for the blessings that we've received today just by being here. Father, we've heard the word proclaimed. We've had the opportunity to sing your praises. Father, we've had the opportunity to see young families come to be a part of our church fellowship. And we just pray your blessings over them today, Father. Help us to continue to seek your will as we seek to be a missions church, Father, that not only goes around the world but seeks to share the gospel here, but everywhere you've called us to through the Great Commission, Lord, whether it's here or the furthest most parts of the earth. Father, help us to see how you want to use us to be a part of that process. Go with us now, Father. Continue to teach us your word. And, Lord, we look forward to all the good things you have in store for us today. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.